Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 31 of Xenogears Dubbed. It's just me and one other person tonight. Say hello.
Hey, everyone, this is Nitrocosm.
Unfortunately, TCM Hero and Blackshade9 could not join us for this episode, but it's okay. They should be here for the series finale. Alright, I guess we're ready to go then, eh, Nitro?
Yeah, let's do it.
Alright. Alright, so we finally get to wrap up the Faye Id story. Seeing in a sec is kind of like, I want to say either a rebirth or something, because it's basically Welltall inside what looks like a sack of sorts and is about to be reborn, but it's not Faye, it's technically Id who's in control.
You know, it wouldn't be a JRPG without some kind of birth, weird allegory thing.
Actually, do you remember an RPG called Wild Arms where the main bad guy was consumed by the mother creature and then reborn as the ultimate final boss? It was weird.
It's like the final boss of Contra.
And if I remember correctly, also there's an umbilical cord.
Now I'm trying to figure out what I'm looking at here.
In terms of the positioning of the gear?
Oh, it's a gear.
Yes.
Neato. That's where gears come from. They told me it came from a stork.
Now, there is more symbolism to this because when you see it, it's like demonic. Because you have like the feathers, or at least, I would say, bat wings kind of sorts from the back of the gear.
Here's looking at you, Zohar. It's staring right at us. Yep, it's got those feather wings. And you know that bears a resemblance to a certain other gear that we're going to see.
Mm-hmm. Alright, so now begins the boss fight, and thankfully the hero's regular gears are actually strong enough to take on this new form, because it would not be fair if they kept getting one-shotted.
Let's see, is the name of this gear True Welltall? Or True Welltall? Sorry, I mispronounced it.
Nope.
Or is it just a red version of a gear that we're about to see later?
I believe it's the red version.
Okay. So what's your point? I'm not gonna fall for it again. Haha, I like the ad-libbing in battle. Go ahead. I like to see you. To be honest, watching these battles without the ad-libbing would be painful.
I mean, you would have to actually think about what they would be saying, or you would just focus entirely on what to do. And lo and behold, we have Wise Man.
Are you okay? Hey, it's Fish Mask.
It's interesting how Wise Man just managed to come in at the right time.
Mm-hmm.
And listening to this episode when I did the voice for Id, normally when I do Id's voice, I do record when I wake up, so this way I have that grovelly type of voice to it. But this one I think I did when I was actually more awake. Because one thing is, trying to replicate the original voice that you had for the character. No, I mean my father. Also, big face reveal. Our fish man is Faye's father. Now, originally TZM was going to be voicing Khan Wong. What happened to Faye? Id. And I think TZM said so that. I think after hearing my interpretation of Khan, that's the reason why he didn't get it, or decided not to go with it. Perfect. Unified whole
has been wasted. Just notice that Khan has quite the headband on.
What is it that you want? That would mean he has a big head.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, that's right, I added punching sound effects, so this way it gave the illusion that they're really going at it, since in the actual game you don't really hear that.
Oh. That's a serious shortcoming of the original game. There's not any sound to even give a hint of what's going on off screen. That's kind of interesting. He says he was created to hide id, as opposed to id being a fracture of his own personality. Were you not going to help Ellie? Or, you know, his personality fractured, I'm not phrasing it well. A fragment. Let's say fragment, not fracture.
The original Faye holds on to all the happiness, and whenever something bad happens, id gets to deal with it. Sounds fair, doesn't it? This is my most treasured possession. And
Who's doing the voice for Kid Faye?
Adair Morrow. Because she's good at young boy voices. And for those who are not able to pick it up, this is the event of Miang awakening inside Faye's mother. She was
like a total. Oh yeah, that's what happened.
Mm-hmm. As we remembered from episode 27, when possessed Karen walked in, Miang had mentioned the previous one became too old. So I would assume that the previous body probably had a power of had some sort of authoritative power and had passed away. Since that tends to be whenever Miang awakens, I guess you could say.
So they were looking for. Contact with Faye. Let's see, they were looking for the. What was the term they used? Was it type and anti-type? This is unbelievable. Mother allowed
this to take place. I just remember that Faye was called the Contact.
Yeah. You know, this is one of those times where it kind of shows just how complex the story to Xenogears is. Things
divided in the past. And it's not like there are any plot holes to be aware of that are relevant, except for, like, which characters are still alive after the apocalypse happened.
Xenogears is so complex that I'm too dumb to find the plot holes in all this complexity. I'm just trying to wrap my mind around it because it's been so long since I played it.
And it's been so long since we did this dub.
Yeah. It's been what, a couple weeks?
Yeah. Hell.
You know, that seems kind of negligent. Oh, I'm so busy with my job, and my kid's telling me he's being dragged off for some weird experiments, but I was tired.
And from a parent's perspective, it's difficult to take your child seriously, because who knows if they're telling the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And here's where we reveal how Faye was able to psychologically split her personality from all the bad stuff. Sort of like a coping mechanism.
Mm-hmm.
From the time of my division from him, I was dominated by hatred.
And that's... I know it's not Child Faye's fault for what he did.
I wanted to destroy everything.
It was just a series of unfortunate circumstances. Father.
Only Ellie was I can't stop looking at Khan's avatar and thinking that his mustache is his mouth.
It also, I understand they're trying to add like an angle to his mustache, but it looks like it was just taped on there and it's starting to fall off.
It does.
And then we realize Khan is Faye. From the future. Contact. Oh man, time travel.
I know I saw a DeLorean in there somewhere.
And that answers your question of what they called Faye, the Contact.
Mm-hmm.
Because we realized that he was also a key part in awakening Gwad.
Gwad!
Oh yeah, here's that cutscene that I kept playing at the end.
What are you doing? This power.
Now, I did the ad-libbing for Graf because it occurred to me last minute, I should probably have TZM do this, but it's already too late in the deadline, so I'm just gonna do it. And were you the one who had mentioned that even though Faye has grown, he's still technically a child?
Yeah, emotionally, he's still extremely immature.
That's what this is?
And it makes sense that he would end up that way because he split his personalities up rather than dealing with things.
And because it was so traumatic for him as a kid, he didn't have the maturity either mentally or emotionally to cope with it. It was like, this is bad, this hurts, mommy and daddy aren't doing anything, this is the only thing I can do. Just shut myself down when this happens. Sort of like an abuse victim.
We killed mother. It's no one's fault.
For some reason... Oh, go ahead.
Sorry. This is some seriously professional grade voice acting right here. Don't look outside for the reason. I gotta just like blowing smoke at you. I mean, this is like what I would hear with a professional dub. No one could have endured
it. With just a Daryl? You can't push
it on it alone. No, both of you guys.
Oh.
We are all one person. We must all become one. Right?
I mean, don't get me wrong, the whole dub sounds pretty good, but this part just stands out.
Face up to the reality that you don't
for some reason.
Show them to Id.
And it's, let me be clear, it's the acting itself that stands out.
And you can only do so much with the way the script is worded.
Karen, what are you doing?
And now we get to see what actually happened. And I wonder if this was done intentionally by Myung, realizing that, okay, mommy's gonna do something, so I'm just gonna hop bodies now.
Yeah, that's what it seemed like happened, because it doesn't seem like she's in there. And you can tell by Faye's facial expression right there that he's already switched personalities to deal with the trauma.
Yep. The graying of the skin.
Lies, that woman.
So that was basically Id when Id was a kid. Before he turned into a kabuki guy.
Yes. Now, one thing I like to know is how Id was able to delve into the other past lives of Faye.
That's a good question.
Our integration is not.
Because he doesn't seem to be cognizant of it. Faye doesn't.
Right.
But it hints that he's able to see way back.
And we're going to go back to what is seemingly the first incarnation, and for those who will eventually realize which incarnation this is...
The God King of No Shame!
And for those wondering, those are basically the genetically modified humans from the ship... So I think those are the... Sorry, go ahead.
GMOs!
Elheim!
I want to say the ones that are not in the robes are the Gazelle Ministry, and then the other four are just like random peons.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, for those who just figure it out, one of them's going to die first, then the other's going to follow suit, because this seems to be a tragic cycle here. And it seems to be Ellie's the first one that dies, and then it's Faye. Over to you. And I remember for this scene, it was basically Myung had orchestrated to get Emeralda and basically sent that squad there to take out both Ellie and Kim. Because Kim wouldn't really want to use Emeralda for a weaponized purpose.
Also, did you notice that one scene there in the laboratory? That scene was set up at an unrealistic camera angle because you could see through the wall into the lab and into the hallway at the same time.
Yep. The limitations of back in the day.
If God doesn't exist in our world, then...
It's almost as if it were doing something that a normal... camera shot couldn't do.
Mm-hmm. And of course we now have the continuation of what happened after Krillian vanished off the face of the earth and how Lacan became Graf. But for some reason he looks like Id.
Why do you turn on me? I thought we were friends.
And also...
What, here?
Yeah.
Who is it?
What's also interesting is, because of Lacan's transition into Graf, is what is the cause of the Diablos situation. Basically, Lacan came in contact with Zohar, got this gear, and then activated, I guess, some sort of system or defense grid that kind of just went about and started killing everybody.
What have I become?
And unfortunately, Graf had also, well, Lacan Graf had killed Roni Fatima, and I think also Renee.
I will live.
Yeah, for some reason, Id is here.
Yeah, and earlier he was reciting Nine Inch Nails lyrics.
And then he's now Graf.
Oh, yeah. There he is. There's our favorite humble power salesman.
And if the world does not come to an end, I will destroy it with my own hands.
And I think for this one, I did not request TZM to record it. Record it as in being Graf's lines, because it was still Lacan talking.
Who is it? Who's calling?
For those who are listening very closely, this is dual voice, both Toku and I. Originally, Blackshade was going to be the third one, so this way there would be three voices talking at once.
God?
And
how in the world did you get this so well synchronized?
Toku recorded the lines first, and then... while I'm listening to it, I would practice trying to sync up my voice with hers.
Oh, I see.
Mm-hmm.
Well, matched up pretty darn good. It's indistinguishable from a sound effect.
Right. And also, there's a slight change in my audio, so this way it makes it sound like it's, I want to say ethereal, if that's the word.
I don't understand what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Or what are you?
Long story short, basically years ago, Zohar just kind of dropped out from its dimensional realm and then appeared in this technically third dimension, as it were, and has been trying to find a way to get back. So it's like, I kind of lost where I was going, but I need to get back now, and I'm going to have all these other things happen.
It ended up in the bottom of a lake in Africa somewhere.
I miss the rains down in Africa.
Oh, wait, no, that... Do what?
I miss the rains down in Africa.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Toto. Heck yeah. I have that album, by the way.
Now,
fun fact...
Oh, go ahead.
I used to listen to the album when I was a little kid all the time. Anyway...
I was going to say, the fourth dimension is a reference to time and relativity, correct?
Yeah.
And how do you feel that would be a part of what Zohar is talking about in Xenogears?
Oh, boy.
give us the viewers at home an abridged version of this while this scene is still going, if you can try.
Okay. Zohar is probably talking about a fifth and maybe sixth dimension. Where if you can extrapolate the concept of dimensions in the first three, which are physical, and the fourth time, you can extrapolate that concept in dimensions that we can't interact with. I believe the Zohar is a type of object that has a shape and size in higher dimensions, and its functionality strongly relies on the laws of physics as they play out using higher dimensions. If that makes any sense at all.
For those, it probably won't, but... I was going to say, not related to Gears, but with Saga, for those who touch the Zohar modifier, they would appear in another, not reality or realm where everything is black and white, but also, like, I want to say probably emotions were also stripped as well.
Yeah, I thought that Xenosaga's illustration of that was kind of half done. Not as, I would have tried to illustrate a little differently, but, you know. I don't think it did a concept any justice. That's one of my criticisms of that game. Fun fact, Killroid X, and this is based in reality, that quantum computers, you know, those things that actually exist in the real world?
Yes.
Supposedly perform their computations by exploiting laws of physics in those higher dimensions I was talking about. I don't know a whole lot about it, and I could be completely wrong. And I'm probably making myself look like a moron, but that's my understanding of it.
Okay, so, for those who didn't get it, back on the Eldritch 10,000 years ago, the first incarnation of Faye, which is what we saw, he couldn't find his mother and was wandering around on the ship and then saw the Zoar, the giant artifact, and because of Faye's strong urge to find his mother, the Zoar reacted and thus created Ellie. So, pretty much, both Faye and Ellie are inseparable because of that.
Mm-hmm. And you know what else it means?
What else?
The Eldritch had the worst security.
It doesn't help that Deus was able to hack into the system and take over the engine room and then the rest of the ship, including its defense system.
That's what happens when you use a password that's easily guessable by dictionary attack. Ye shall be as gods.
Pretty much.
I mean, they didn't even swap letters with numbers.
And also another fun theory I also wanted to point out, this actually read in the Xenogears wiki, that the captain from the Eldritch, that was, if I remember correctly, the father of the first incarnation of Faye. There was a supposed rumor going around about that. I am not joking about that, and I want to say that the people, or the mother and daughter in the locket were probably related to the first incarnation of Faye, because
I thought that.
Oh, go ahead.
Sorry, I thought that picture in the watch was just the stock photo that came with the watch.
Nope, because if I remember, it's either the mother or the daughter that looks very similar to Ellie, or at least Elheim in this case. And also, there is an image on Google that there is one frame or one scene that's cut out where you see like the first incarnation of Ellie, and then I think also Sophia, but the hairstyle is different. If I can find it, I'll probably show you later.
Ooh, I'd like to see that. That's neat.
Yeah, but remember, I'm reading this from a Xenogears wiki, and if it's one of the more official ones, then you know something's up. Alright, so Faye has become whole. He's now resolved his conflict with Child Faye and Id, and then had a talk with Zoar, and now suddenly he has all his past lives. Everything's all hunky-dory. And Kansei, so, he's become one.
There's no more Id.
Yep. But Kansei's not looking so good. I wonder why.
Because he ugly? This is,
after all, no.
Dad? I know, so. I'm just kidding.
You and I must become one!
Oh no! A plot twist!
Dun dun dun!
Now, something interesting here with throughout this scene with Graf and Faye. Originally, TZM had requested for the final debut of Graf that he wanted to do the lines. You know, he felt really bad about it. And so what happened was, I had originally recorded the lines as Graf, but throughout this scene you're going to hear TZM's and mine. And this helps kind of give the realization that Khan is still inside there at some point.
Of course, they were just parts of me. I couldn't hold on to Khan totally. His ego far stronger than I imagined.
And I think TZM did a good job as a send-off for Graf.
Mm-hmm.
You have awakened. His body's now useless.
And I remember another idea I had was I was going to keep my audio and then use TZM's and kind of like do a dual voice where it's both Graf and Lacan talking to Faye at the same time.
I hear you, Faye. You see, he and I are one. I am Khan. Khan is me. He has become one with me. So you two should open.
So, what's your take on both TZM and I doing the voice here of Graf on certain lines?
I think you guys did a good job of sounding like each other to the point where sometimes I can't tell who's doing it.
Good. Well, I say good as in that you enjoyed it.
I mean, that's what you're going for, right? To have a particular voice that you could both do.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? I just realized the gears in the background are sprites, not 3D.
Because
they kind of jumped when they were rotating the scene. It wasn't smooth.
To give you like the impression that they were just part of the background as backdrops, not like.
Well, I can tell that they're sprites because they're not rotating. Which makes sense because you got to remember the PlayStation 1 had very limited capabilities, and the poly count in this scene is already pretty high because Xenogears, the gear, obviously is a relatively high poly model.
Now, Graf's gear was originally called Original Veltal or Veltal OR, but in this one, this is the true Veltal, as it were.
Yeah, this is what I thought the other one was. But yeah, this is true Veltal.
So I guess that would make. Oh, that's right, because Veltal was basically a gear meant for id. So, the Veltal that Faye has been using is kind of like a copycat. But would also that make Faye's gear an anima relic as well? Playing, or after doing this scene, when I played it back in the day, I actually felt bad for Graf. Our objectives should be the because it seemed like, oh, maybe we'll get Graf as like a playable character on our side, but not the case. Because Zahar's like, you know, that debt? I need to claim that back.
That would have been cool if Graf could have been a playable character and joined the party at some point.
Mm-hmm. Of course. Having Ramses as a playable character would have been a fun thing, but it's not.
Mm-hmm.
This is what Lacan wanted all along. After all, I'm an imperfect existence. It was inevitable that it would come to this.
Good job, TZM.
Considering what had happened in the past, Lacan's imperfect secondary contact.
So
now I want to.
Oh, go ahead.
Now I want some power. Just out of pity, I want some power.
Anyways, so yeah, Graf is basically sacrificing himself to buy them enough time so Zohar doesn't go and try to absorb Lacan, or Faye.
I see.
Lived on separately by possessing the bodies of others. That is Graf. That is me. I may have inherited Lacan's will, but I'm not the same as the contact Lacan. Is it possible?
If we were talking Evangelion, it's like Graf is the dummy plug inside Ava 1. Since the Avas are composed of Shinji's dead mother.
Mm-hmm. Get in the robot, Shinji.
Too much Evangelion references in this game. But that's okay.
Yeah, it's funny because I played this game before I saw Evangelion.
I saw Evangelion. Oh, go ahead.
I didn't watch Evangelion until like 2001 when I got it on DVD. The whole series.
I was going to say for me it was the exact opposite because I knew somebody in high school who was able to let me borrow the VHS fan subs of Ava.
Dad. As you said,
That was Karen. There are many generations. Yang is beginning to break free from her bonds. Now that Elheim has merged with the Deus, she has all of her memories back. All of the memories from her original birth as the Contact's complement.
Yeah, I keep thinking that most people play, well, I played Xenogears the, not right when it came out, because I didn't know about it, but in 1999, so this is about a year after it came out in Japan. I found out about Xenogears the way most people probably did. I saw that demo on the CD that came with Parasite Eve.
Mm-hmm. And that's the end of Graf. Sacrificed himself so this way the heroes could stop Deus. I guess you could say Graf is an anti-hero.
Yep.
And in a way, he wanted to destroy God. God being Deus. So, in a way, Graf had good intentions of how he wanted to go about it, but it was just the way the game was set up to make it seem like he's doing something terrible.
Yeah, a while back we kind of saw that maybe Graf's intentions weren't quite as malevolent as they seemed early in the game.
Mm-hmm. And now we're in another area that we actually cannot explore.
Yep, but we do see it much later, as in the last thing we see in the entire game.
Long ago, Deus crash-landed on this planet in an interplanetary colony ship. In order to revive itself someday, Deus detached the Zor modifier's core.
And of course, we learn how humanity was created. It wasn't exactly Adam and Eve related, but it's close enough.
After she awoke, she used all her power to bear several beings. These will
become the all of humanity. They're standing roughly in the place where the scene in the very beginning of the game is, right after the Zohar crash. Because we see that in the background.
And I'm sure there's an ocean somewhere nearby.
Yeah.
The subject and the complement. That is Ellie and Mia. I, the sole survivor from the colony ship, met Ellie. Everything started from there.
This is what we call the butterfly effect, folks.
There's a skeleton in there.
You know, it surprises me that also, if you look closer, you can still see the purple hair in the tube. I figure at this point, the proteins would have already dried up.
Yeah.
So I guess human hair can last 10,000 years?
There are mummies that have some of their hair intact. I think.
Possibly. Now, if we remember correctly, Deus was created by, I forget the name of the, whatever humanity called itself, some sort of federation of sorts, basically to terraform a planet into a weapon. And if I remember correctly, it was meant to be used on the planet that the refugees who are on board the Eldridge were.
That is the absolute opposite of what it is supposed to be doing. Maybe there aren't enough parts.
Sorry, I'm just trying to remember how Deus came to be, and then what led up to when the Eldritch crashed. And I think there was also a theory going around that Deus was trying to go back to Lost Jerusalem, aka Earth, in the Xenogears universe.
Yeah, that's what I've read that somewhere, that Deus took over because it was trying to make the Eldritch take it back to Lost Jerusalem.
Yeah, because in the opening cutscene they just say the main planet, but we don't know if they're talking about Earth or the planet that it was originally on, which was, I believe, Mictum.
It was probably given this unique will by someone, either from Ellie, who is murdered.
Yeah, I gotta play through Xenosaga again. I know it's not an official prequel, but come on.
It just took bits and pieces from Gears and tried to do it in its own unique way, and of course, that's if we had the other three episodes that were planned.
Mm-hmm.
The secret battleship Excalibur will also take part in the final battle.
Okay.
That's what Sorry.
No, I was going to say, okay, so they're on the Excalibur.
Okay. And I was just going to say that whenever I talk to someone about Xenosaga versus Xenogears, I always say that it's I know it's not the official prequel, but come on.
It just reminds me of other Flame Wars that went on about, oh yeah, episode 5 is going to be just like Xenogears, and we're going to see everything that happened. The only thing I can think of is, are you absolutely sure that's going to be the case? Because we will never know.
Yeah. Honestly, I think it's just whatever you want to imagine. Because it's a work of fiction to begin with, so.
Yeah. And that's why people do fan fictions.
Mm-hmm. I read one of them.
The one that I have yet to read is called Xenogears After the Fall, which is actually, if it was, well, it would be two ebooks worth because, yeah, reasons. Which is funny because in After the Fall, all the characters lived. So
oh my
died.
Gosh! Well, holy poop, I forgot I was in this!
Another thing I liked about Xenogears is the character's input on what to do in regards to planning. But then we allow Satan to talk, and then he comes up with a better idea.
When Excalibur's barrier expires,
also, this is the first time Bart has actually explained a plan.
Yeah, usually he's just all like pasta.
If you mean by explosions. Shoot, yeah. Talk later. But this time it's actually talk now and then think about how to shoot later. But at the same time, it's kind of a waste of a gear. Because we only get to use the Adrastil for once in the actual game.
Yeah, slave generator, because in Xenogears, the Zohar is the source of all ether energy, so all the generators that use ether are, I guess they're taking the power that comes from the Zohar and they're amplifying it or harnessing it somehow. The Zohar is like a master generator. However in the heck that's supposed to work, I imagine some kind of electromagnetic phenomenon.
A majority, well, actually 99% of what's on the surface has been taken out. You can still go to certain places on the world map, so excuse you, Faye.
Yeah, I thought that was weird.
Like, you can still go to Nortun, but the only place you can access is the battle arena, and that's where you can do, like, the two-player fighting game. So that's where you can use, like, gears that made an appearance, but you can actually play in the game.
Oh, FMV!
Oh, man, look at this right here.
1,000 hours in Blender. Or they probably use 3D Studio Max or something.
Well, if you think about it, it's actually kind of impressive in the PS1 era.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's all pre-rendered.
Xenogears is known for its 2D and 3D animation. Unfortunately, this is like the second time we see the Adrastil 4 in action before it's destroyed. Maybe one day if they do a remake, we'll actually get to use the Adrastil 4 in like the big assault against Merkava. I think that'd be pretty cool.
What is that? that they're riding on there?
That is, I believe, a part of the Adrassil.
Oh, they blowed up the Adrassil, didn't they? No, wait, there it is. They're on it.
Yeah.
A secondary explosion.
Nope, there's DCM.
Oh no, I should have known better. What a miscalculation.
Oh.
The explosion was too big.
The main condenser right under the main cannon. Didn't blow up right. Oh.
How could I be so stupid?
Man, Satan's being kind of hard on himself there. You still with me?
Yep.
Okay.
No, I just noticed for a second that I think there was a desync there with Bart's dialogue when he said, "You mean we overdid it?" So I was just having a momentary lapse there. But unfortunately, that plan failed. Merkava exploded, but now Deus is kind of awake and is about to start terraforming the planet.
Oh, it's a Stay Puft Marshmallow Monster.
Back when I had a Game Shark, it was the one that you could actually input your own codes in. There was a moment where actually the cannon beak thing on Deus stretched to near infinity when you got closer to it. It was kind of creepy but funny at the same time.
And it just terraformed a whole big old bunch of the planet.
The earthquake and shook. Yeah. And that was just in a few seconds. It probably won't be long before it terraforms the entire planet. Oh, you haven't seen Deus' final form yet, Faye. This is like the second form.
This isn't even my final form.
And that's the truth. It's not. But we will see Deus' final form in the series finale of Xenogears dubbed.
Yep. When we do the evil Bossa Nova.
Well, Nitro, we survived episode 31.
We did. I can't believe it. We got one more episode to go, and then we're done. We're going to finish.
Yep. We're going to need everybody on board for this, because it's going to be 53 freaking minutes.
It's going to be extreme. Okay. I hope we can get everyone on board. That would be cool.
Yeah, it's like the final episode. Come on, guys. We need to do this.
Yeah, pull it in, guys. Be a sport. Do the game.
But yeah, it's... We're gonna finish this. Damn. I'm still proud of myself for the clip comparison that I did here.
One of the few fan dubs on YouTube that was done all the way to completion. And now it's about to be one of the commentaries, one of the totally complete commentaries of a totally complete fan dub on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
My old YouTube link, which no longer works.
Oh well.
I couldn't get that username back. I was so mad.
All right. Thanks for tuning in, everybody. We're going to see the previews for the last episode, but other than that, thanks for tuning in.
Mm-hmm.
Everything has fallen into place. The final battle is about to begin. Next, the final chapter of Xenogears dubbed, episode 32.
Oh my god, I'm so excited.
Wow, January 18th, 2012.
And yeah, that episode 32 part was a last minute recording when I realized I didn't say it. I'm like, oh, I should put that in there. Alright, good night.